The speaker is Michel Tebar. He's well known. It is also, I think, your first time here. Okay. And he's going to speak about all the new results on enlargements for of maximally monotone operators. So we have your plan.
Okay. Thank you, Juan. So I'm very glad to be here for the first time to give a talk in CIO. So thank you for your invitation, Lola and Ravi. And also my congratulations to organize this series of workshops. And now it's a little bit like Allel, so it's a series, it starts to be a series of workshop. So today I will speak about enlargement of maximally monotone operators. And also I want to take this opportunity to thank Regina Buracic, without C, for bringing me back to this area of monotone operators. I worked in this area now many years ago with many collaborators, and it is an interesting, very interesting area. I remember, I think I left this area after writing some nice result with Juan Enrique. And then, as you know, I moved to variational analysis with my students. So now I'm back. And so it is also a joint work with Mabou Berizai, who was a postdoc from me some years ago in Limoges, and after with Regina. Okay, so I will speak about the motivation. We'll remind quickly basic fact on convex analysis and monotone operator theory. I will remind two natural enlargement, and more important, I will define a new family of enlargement, and I will end the lecture by the specific case of the subdifferential of a lower semi-continuous function. Okay. So motivation. This talk is motivated by the study of generalized equations, which are governed by maximally monotone operators T from a Banach space X to its dual X star, and more precisely, one of the important problems is the problem of finding zero of a maximal monotone operator, which means finding an X in X such that zero belongs to T of X. And as you know, this problem has been extensively used for modeling various problems, and the set of solutions of this kind of problem is relevant in optimization and in fixed point theory, for instance. For instance, let me give three examples. If X is a Hilbert space, and if the operator T is an identity minus F, where F is a non-expressive mapping, then the set of solution of one coincides with the set of fixed point of the non-expressive mapping F. Now, when T is a maximally monotone operator, the set of solution of one coincides with the set of fixed point of the resolvent of the maximally monotone operator T, or what we call the KLA operator, which is C minus 2 times the resolvent minus the identity. And more known from you is the case where T is a subdifferential of a lower semi-continuous function, and in this case the set of solution of one, of course, coincides with the set of minimizer of the function f under consideration. But when you are interested in this problem, one, So this problem could be ill-behaved, and if you are working from a numerical point of view, which is not my case, by the way, but I know that it's computation may be difficult. Okay, and so we need to find perturbation of the initial problem by enlarging the operator, the initial operator T, without losing any information on T, and we want the perturbed problem related to the enlargement of the operator be numerically more robust, and the solution has to approximate accurately the solution of the original problem. Okay? And of course, the use of enlargement in the study of of finding a zero of a generalized equation governed by a maximal Hamiltonian operators has been intensively studied from an abstract and also from a numerical point of view, and especially in the case of optimization when the operator is a subdifferential of a lower semi-continuous function. Okay, and for instance, as you know, it has allowed to construct specific numerical methods for convex non-smooth optimization, and it goes back, I think, to people, for instance, like Ostlander in France, Kiwi, Le Maréchal, Solodov, etc. Okay? So, from the point of view of optimization, enlargement of operators is interesting. And using this optimization approach that we know, we will use this optimization approach, I will say, as a benchmark to study problem well by using enlargement of T. And for this, we will first recall some fact about already known about enlargement, and then introduce a new enlargement for maximally monotone operators. And enlargement in general, and in particular, the new enlargement I will show you later, should share with the epsilon subdifferential most of its good properties. Okay? Local boundedness, demi-closeness of the graph, Lipschitz continuity, and what we call the Bronstedt-Rockefeller property. Okay? And so, basic fact, but very quick, you know, so F, the domain is denoted like this. The subdifferential is this set, and the epsilon subdifferential is this set. Okay? And of course, you know that when epsilon is zero, the subdifferential is exact. The epsilon subdifferential is exactly the subdifferential. For now, notation for monotone operators, for operators in general, or set-valued mapping, more generally speaking, the graph. Three sets are important: the graph of an operator, the domain of an operator, which is a set where the it has non-empty value, and the range of an operator. Okay, and also important for this lecture is the property of for an operator to be monotone, which is well known. It has been recalled this morning by our friend Juan Enrique. And also, when you have a monotone operator, you have the concept of maximal monotone operator, but now everybody speaks about maximally monotone operator, which is, from the English point of view, I've been told by Simons, it is more accurate than maximal monotone operator. Okay. So, so an operator is maximally monotone if and only if this condition it has no monotone extension, in fact. Okay? for the inclusion of the graphs. And one well-known fact is the fact that the subdifferential of a lower semi-continuous proper function is maximally monotone. And this fact goes back to Moreau in 65, when X is an Hilbert space. And then we have a proof for Banach space given by Rockefeller. And then, as I will mention later, you have new proof using the theory of Fitzpatrick function that I will introduce later in this talk. Okay? So now the concept of conjugate. And the thing, this function will be very important. Okay? So a function defined on the Cartesian product of X and the dual X star. So J of X, XX, X star is the sum of F of X plus the conjugate of F at X star. G is a convex proper, proper and lower semi-continuous function with respect to norm strong in the first variable, weak star in the second variable. Okay? And one fact which is very important is that this function J completely characterizes the graph of the subdifferential of F, which means that the subdifferential of F at X is a set of X star in X star such that F of X plus F star of X star equal G of X X star equal the duality product between X and X star. Okay? Okay, now I will speak about two enlargements. Okay? I will define, given a maximally monotone operator, T, I will define a family of convex functions associated to it as follows. And this family will be denoted by script H of T. So, you have T a maximally monotone operator. And this family, H, script H of T, is the family of lower semi-continuous convex function on the product space X, X star, with possible value minus infinity and plus infinity. But satisfying this condition 5 and 6, which are the following, H of X, and I did a mistake, it should be X star, because we are not, okay, greater than X star of X for every X in X and X star in X star, okay, and also X star belongs to T of X if and only if H of X, X star equal V star, X star applied to X. Okay? We use this notation V when it's an Hilbert space in general, but in the dual we, okay, to be, to have a standard notation, I see. So I'm sorry about, I forgot this. And this family of function H has a smallest element, which is called the Fitzpatrick function associated to the operator T. And as reminded this morning Juan Enrique, this Fitzpatrick function, which was introduced in a paper for a conference in Australia in 1988, is defined by this relation 7. The Fitzpatrick function applied to X and X star, okay, is a supremum of these terms when Y and Y star run on the graph of the operator T. Okay? Oh, equivalently, by the way, it could be, I think that Juan Enrique gave this formula this morning. Okay? But in fact, this is the same. Okay? And Also, these facts are well known, that the phase perfect function associated to the operator T at x star equals this, if and also to the conjugate, but at x star x, if and only if x and x star are in the graph of T, and when the operator is a subdifferential of a lower semi-continuous function, then we have this set of inequalities. The phase perfect function associated is greater than this, but is less than equal, as you know, of f of x and f plus f of x star. And I just want to say one word about phase perfect function. It has led to considerable simplifications of the proof of classical property of maximally monotone operators, and a lot of work has been done in this direction, including many people, but Simons, Marques, Alves, and Sveter, Simons and Zalinescu, Bowen, and many others. Okay. Also, Juan Enrique. And another thing, that Fitzpatrick also defined a correspondence which goes in the opposite direction. So given a bivariate function of x and x star, he defined the operator T sub j associated to j from x to x star in this sense. So T sub g of x is a set of x star in x star such that the pair x star x is in the subdifferential of the bivariate function g. And this will be important for the remaining part of the talk. Okay, the following theorem summarizes those results by Fitzpatrick relevant to this talk. Okay, the first theorem, if you have a monotone operator with domain non-empty and you consider T sub FT, okay, where you remember you replace J by FT, okay, and then you have that the T of X is included in T sub FT, and if T is maximally monotone, T is exactly equal to T sub of T. Okay? So the operator associated to the Fitzpatrick function. And if T is maximally monotone, then this Fitzpatrick function belongs to the family I've defined with these two properties. Okay? And moreover, and I think that you didn't tell this morning, the Fitzpatrick function is a minimal convex function in this family H sub script F script H of T. And also, if F is convex, then T sub F is monotone. And extension of theorem 1a, we have extension of this first part of the theorem 1 in this following way. If T is a maximally monotone operator, and if you fix a function H in this family script H of T, then T equals T sub H. So, you have natural enlargement. And one of the natural enlargement, which has been studied by many authors, is given T, you define, you have in mind what is the epsilon subdifferential, so it's natural to extend the definition of the epsilon subdifferential to a monotone operator in this way. Okay, so we show in a paper published in Journal of Nonlinear and Convex Analysis with Juan Enrique, and by the way, this paper is one of the most cited paper I wrote, me, at least. And thanks to you, is that the inclusion maybe strict. Okay? And this operator T epsilon shares with the epsilon subdifferential many properties: local boundedness, demi-closeness of graph, and also I will define later what it is, a transportation formula, and Lipschitz continuity with respect T being or not a subdifferential.
Demi-closed is as a French mathematical term,
then,
or not,
semi-closed,
or
demi-closed?
Demi-closed, because you have a subset of X times X star, so you assume that the sequence in X converges strongly and X star converges weakly, and vice versa.
Okay. Exactly.
And then when the limits belong to the self, then...
Exactly, but it will be clear later. Additionally, if X is reflexive, this T epsilon satisfies what we call the Brown state Rockefeller property. I will recall later what it is. Okay? Exactly here. So we say, you know, there is a previous theorem due to Brown state and Rockefeller concerning the subdifferential of a function of lower semitone continuous proper function, which is the following. But this can be generalized to an operator T from X to X star, and we say that the operator T satisfies the Brown state Rockefeller property if for all X naught in X and X naught star in X star and alpha strictly positive, if you have this relation for X and X star in the graph of T, then you have these two inequalities. And it has been proved by Toralba and also independently, I will say, by Sweiter. Maybe you were in this paper, I don't remember.
I was.
You were. So I'm sorry, I didn't mention your name. Because I know more the work by Toralba, because I was one of the referee of his thesis, and so his why.
We didn't know because it was.
I know, but I know also that it has been recovered by you and by Sweiter. I was sure because I have a hard correspondence with him at this time.
You should have tried with me.
Okay, I should, and so. In any reflexive Banach space, every maximally monotone operator has the Brown state Rockefeller property. Okay? So now we'll talk about enlargement in general. Also, you have a multifunction. You say that E from R plus times X to X star belongs to this family ET, E like enlargement, T like operator related to operator T, when this property holds, E1, TFX is included in the enlargement, E2, if epsilon 1 is less than epsilon 2, then the enlargement works like this, and this famous so-called transportation formula introduced by Sweiter and you. Okay? This transportation formula reads as follows. If you take V1 and V2 in this enlargement but respect to X1, epsilon 2, X2, you define a convex combination of X1 and X2, a convex combination of V1 and V2, and if you define epsilon at like this, then you have that V at, this convex combination of V1 and V2, belongs to the enlargement with respect to epsilon at and X at. Okay, and the family of enlargement has been introduced by Sweiter in 2000, and also you can effectively this book, this work, different work with Buracik and Sveiter in 1999, 2002, 2006. So, the family of enlargement of T shares with the epsilon subdifferential, shares with the epsilon subdifferential some properties: local boundedness, demi-closed of the natural graph, Lipschitz continuity, and the Brollstein-Rockefeller properties. So it extends in this way the epsilon subdifferential. Okay, and also it is known that T epsilon is the largest member of this family of enlargement, and when T is the subdifferential, T epsilon is strictly larger, as I recalled previously, than the epsilon subdifferential. And this is not, this is a wrong word, it's not a conjecture, it's a consequence of this. Since we have this, it is natural to expect that some property of the epsilon subdifferential are not shared by every enlargement family of ET, and in particular not shared by T epsilon. And as you will see later, this one of the properties which is not shared is what we call additivity property. Okay? So now I am changing a little bit the notation. So the epsilon subdifferential, I will denote it is an enlargement. It is an enlargement in the sense I have defined, and so I denote by this symbol the epsilon subdifferential. Okay? And this enlargement, I will call it the Brønsted-Rockefeller enlargement. Okay? And this, the transportation for this, of course, the transportation formula was for the epsilon subdifferential. This I skip it. And if the domain of the operator is non-empty, the family of enlargement related to T is non-empty, and it has a biggest element, this T epsilon, which now I call is TE. Okay? And the enlargement, we have that belongs to the enlargement of the subdifferential. Okay, now, how much I have time?
3 or 4 minutes.
Oh my God. So, now I want to introduce a new enlargement, okay? A new family, and the inspiration goes back to the 1988 paper by Fitzpatrick. Okay, so, if you have T, a monotone operator from X to X star with non-empty domain, you fix one function h in this family, h script h of t. And for epsilon positive, we consider this mapping r from r plus time x to x star defined in this way. Okay? Then, from this definition, which is not 8, I think, I don't know. If you have that the operator associated to J is exactly this one, and interesting is that if you have a reflexive Ballard space and if T is a maximally monotone operator with non-empty domain, you have that this family, this new family, okay, of enlargement is included in the family, the general family of enlargement. Okay? So it means that it is really an enlargement. And now you will see the definition of demi-closed or semi-closed, if you prefer, Marco. For every x in the domain of T, the set this set is convex, the graph of this enlargement is demi-closed, in the sense that if you have a sequence xn which converges for the strong topology to x, and x star, xn star is in this set, converges weakly to x bar, and epsilon n goes to the epsilon, then x star belongs to this set. And in particular, this set is weakly closed. And if T is a maximally monotone operator, and if H is fixed in this family script H of T, then the operator TH is exactly this set for every X in the domain of T. Oh. We have as a corollary that this enlargement, new enlargement, is included in the biggest one, of course, which was defined. And in particular, the operator associated, the operator associated to the Fitzpatrick function is included in this. And one fact important, if you have a maximally monotone operator, this new enlargement has good properties, have all the good properties I've recalled of the epsilon subdifferential, and these properties, for instance, and in particular the Bronsted-Rockefeller property. Okay? I'm trying to go fast now, no, but I just want to go to the end. You know that I will say that an enlargement is additive, it is satisfies this condition. So you have two enlargements with respect to epsilon 1 and epsilon 2. Then if you have this, and we say that an enlargement is maximally additive, max add for short, if you have this maximality with respect to the addition. Okay? If this one contains this one, then if E is maximally additive, then necessarily E prime has to be equal to E. Okay? And for instance, the subdifferential, the epsilon subdifferential is max add. Satisfies this property. And for an arbitrary maximal monotone operator T, the smallest enlargement of T is always additive. And applying Zorn's lemma, we can it exists a max additive enlargement of T. And Buracik and Sweiter in 1999 prove that the additivity does not hold for this enlargement T epsilon or T now called of T. And in fact, they proved that in Hilbert space, if you have a maximally monotone operator, this formula holds. And no, this is not epsilon 1 plus epsilon 2. Okay? This is exactly this. So it's not additive. So maybe I will skip this. Okay. But important is this result. For every H in script H of T, our enlargement is additive. But I need this, sorry. To every H prime in script H of T, we can associate an unique enlargement as follows. Oh, sorry. And conversely, to every enlargement, we can associate an H in script H of T such that this enlargement is exactly this one. And if H equals its own conjugate, then the new enlargement is max R. It means that all the members of script H of T are max R. Okay? And finally, we have this result, which gives a relation when the operator is the subdifferential. For every epsilon strictly positive and x in the domain of the subdifferential, you have this connection between the two enlargements. It means that some specific element of script HT are contained in the epsilon subdifferential enlargement. Okay? And the second one is this formula. This means HFY is a function associated to the HF sub FY of X, X star is F of X plus F of X star, F star of X star. Okay? The Fenchel-Young. This means Fenchel-Young. And so, with this bivariate function, Fenchel-Young, okay, you have that, this formula. So it means that a specific element, this one, of script HT, coincide with the epsilon subdifferential. So the epsilon subdifferential could be characterized by one, by this specific function in script H of T. Okay? So, conclusion, and then lunch. We have introduced a new enlargement having all the good properties known for enlargement, plus the property that all its members are max R. When T is a subdifferential, some specific element, just the one I mentioned to you, of this family are included in the subdifferential and coincide. Okay? So the basic reference is this paper by Fitzpatrick, given for this workshop in in Australia. This paper, I am proud of this paper, Juan Enrique. Of course, my co-authors, Regina, has written a lot of paper. She's a specialist of enlargement, and I'm glad to cite Sveter also. Is one of the person, leading person in this area. And this is, the most cited paper in the future. Thank you for your attention.